Well, I'm very excited to introduce my friend Brian Smedley. I last heard him speak at the UN before a packed house of 500 people talking about health disparities, and I'm sure this panel will be equally exciting to the panels that came before it. And so I will let Brian introduce the panelists and we'll get going.
Thank you so much, Barry. I'm really delighted and honored to be here. I want to thank the APA for organizing this important conference. We are here tasked with understanding the implications of culture and demographics for this charge of developing high-quality integrated care models. And so this particular charge, of course, is challenging in the U.S. context because the health inequities that we see are deep and persistent. There are many population groups, many communities of color, lower socioeconomic groups, LGBT populations, and others that face persistent health care access and quality disparities. And so to address these challenges, we have to think about centering equity into our integrated care models. A huge challenge in the U.S. context, particularly because we are unique among Western nations in terms of how we finance and deliver care. And so this distinguished panel will help us to understand these dynamics and understand how it is that we can begin to develop models of integrated care that take into account the particular needs, challenges, and opportunities to address the needs for disparity populations, addressing populations according to need rather than a cookie cutter approach to integrated care. Very delighted that this distinguished panel has agreed to join us. I'm going to introduce them, and they'll each come up in turn. First, Dr. Carlos Castillo-Salgado is professor in the Department of Epidemiology at the Bloomberg School of Public Health with joint appointments in the Department of Population, Family, and Reproductive Health in the School of Medicine at Johns Hopkins University. He's pioneered the development of applied and field epidemiology training programs for public health professionals in the Americas. And of course, you can read his full biography in your program. To his left is Dr. Lark Wong, a licensed clinical community psychologist and senior advisor in the Administrator's Office of Policy Planning and Innovation at the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services. In this position, she provides leadership on national policy for mental health and substance use issues for children, adolescents, and families, and importantly, leads the Administrator's Strategic Initiative on Trauma and Justice. She's also director of SAMHSA's Office of Behavioral Health Equity, which was legislated by the Affordable Care Act. Finally, delighted to have Dr. Alex Scott Samuel join us from the UK. Since 1994, he's been senior clinical lecturer in the Division of Public Health at the University of Liverpool, where he directs the International Health Impact Assessment Consortium, the Liverpool Public Health Observatory, and Equity in Health Research and Development Unit. His research interests are in health impact assessment, health politics and policy, and is known internationally for his work on health inequality. So please join me in welcoming this distinguished panel. And we'll start with Dr. Castillo-Salgado.
Good morning. And thank you very much, Brian and the American Psychological Association for the opportunity to share with you some of the experiences that we have both through the worker organization, the Pan American Health Organization, in which I worked for 22 years as the Director of Epidemiology for the Americas. Currently, I am in the faculty of the Department of Epi, making some transformations in the way of training public health professionals, particularly linking the role of health equity in our programs. And I will be addressing the role of health equity in the new innovative training programs at Hopkins. But not only is Hopkins, it's also the experience that we have with training most of the public health managers in Latin America and Spain. 12 years ago, when I was still the director of EPI in the Pan American Health Organization, we decided to incorporate a new training program in which health equity was the center. And this has been a very successful program. It's 11 months in which we address health equity and professional epidemiology for the senior public health managers, including the current president of Chile. Dr. Bachelet actually is a pediatrician and epidemiologist by training. Most of the ministers of health in Latin America have been also taking this program. I want to emphasize what has been all the morning, the importance of the context and how we do operational research that is linked to health equity. There are several elements that we need to take into account to put that into the practical perspective. First, the urbanization process in all the globe. Latin America now is 80% urban, and the way as we do primary health care and the models of care has been different, and we are not very experienced in the model at the urban settings, particularly in the context of the slums. Also, I want to emphasize that there is a polarization of the health burden. In the past, we thought that we were in the epidemiological transition in which communicable diseases were disappearing and only chronic diseases will appear. Actually, we have the triple burden, particularly in the most vulnerable areas in both rural and urban settings. For all of you that have been following the last 20 years, the communicable diseases has been exploding, and now we have each every 2 years a new disease that was not known by the globe. And those diseases were appearing every 100 years. Now they are appearing every 2 years. This is a very important consideration for the new vision of public health. Obviously, healthcare is not sufficient to address all these challenges. The third challenge that many areas in urban and rural settings are being affected are injury and the accidents and violence. In addition to the chronic diseases, we have this triple burden. In order to address that, we need to think about strategic frameworks, we call operational frameworks, that allow us to link the distal determinants that are the social determinants with the proximal determinants. Most of our research has been dealing with the proximal determinants. That's what many of the epi and public health studies have been done. And now we are almost forcing the new generations to understand the pathways in which we need to have actionable factors. It's not only to think at the philosophical level, but also in the practical level. How urban settings, urban, and we call the role of the neighborhoods, how they could address these distal determinants. We know also that, unfortunately, the medical knowledge is translated very quickly. It takes 3 years to disseminate it. The public health knowledge is taking 20 years to be implemented. Many times, and we conducted several studies to recognize that although we have the knowledge, we don't use the knowledge in public health. And that's, I think, something that we need to address too in terms of the health inequalities. We need also to have not only one single method, we need to combine different methods to address the main problems. Why we need to do it? Actually, it's because individual and population health is highly affected by these distal determinants. But what is very important is how we will be getting the information and the measurement elements that we discussed, and some of the questions were posed in the previous panel. Measurement and part of the social determinants of health and the the commission, I was part of the commission in terms of the metrics component, we needed to develop new public health metrics. And most of the new public health metrics need to be equity focused. Even if we have a primary healthcare measurements, we need to add the equity focus. And that's perhaps is one of the most important implications in measurements. Most of the metrics that we use are very old, and they are not addressing actually the health equity gaps in different populations. In that sense, we need to recognize that we need to add into our portfolio of operational research the development of these new metrics. We will see that there are many equity new global metrics, but also we need to go to the local level. I think the local level is now the focus of our intervention. The example that we have is Baltimore City and Brooklyn. We already are linking primary health care with the profiles of the neighborhoods. We developed the 50 neighborhood profiles of the Baltimore City, and we recognize that there are 20 years of difference in life expectancy in the worst neighborhoods versus the best neighborhoods. But also, we start doing in Brooklyn to understand the different considerations in terms of cultural characteristics of the different neighborhoods in Brooklyn. We are asking now the hospital and the primary healthcare providers that they need to see the actual context and the profiles of patients that they are not successful in responding to the treatment. Now, the electronic medical record is signaling that they need to change the way of seeing the patient. They must understand what is the context of the patients. And I think this is something that will be very relevant to link population health with primary health care. Because of the time, I think I will be mentioning that it's quite critical to incorporate these new operational frameworks that are actionable. It's not only theoretical, they are operational. What are the windows of opportunities for us professionals and for the community leaders to start solving some of the local health problems? And engaging the civil society will be critical, and for us is to develop new information systems that will be disaggregating the information by the local characteristics of the equity and the gaps. I will be leaving here and having perhaps the opportunity to discuss some of the questions that you could have about the implementation of these new training programs. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Lark Wong from SAMHSA, and I want to thank Brian and Barry Anton for inviting me to be part of this meeting. I don't thank them for the task that they've given us to address. It's a very big one to think about integrated care, cultural disparities, social justice. But Dr. Troutman did a great job of starting us out on that today. So I interpreted the question as or the task is, can we think about integrated care as a pathway to health equity, as one pathway to health equity? So I'm going to share with you some data, share with you some efforts going on at SAMHSA, some federal government efforts, and leave it up to you whether you think we're really conceptualizing integrated care as a way to really get at some of the social justice issues, some of the value propositions that make it an untenable situation that we have such a healthcare system that does so much injustice to some of our populations in this country. Okay, so as we think of integrated care, can it be a pathway to health equity? And part of the assumption in that is, how do we define integrated care? And I think we're defining it in a number of different ways here. But first, I want to just share with you some sort of quick snapshots on disparities-related data that the federal government puts out every year. This is put out by the Department of Health and Human Services, by the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality. They do a national report on health disparities. And it is based on a number of different federal surveys and collects about 250 different indicators of quality of care and access to care. And it looks at income differences. I'm sorry that this is so small. If you look to the far right, the two slides on the two bars on the far right are looking at low income versus high income, middle versus high income. The other bars are looking at different racial ethnic groups in reference to the white population. The white population is always used as a referent group. The black bars indicate where there is improvement. The blue part of the bar indicates a status quo, no change, and the green bars represent where it's worsening. So if you look at it across the bars from the left to the right, in for all populations, black is on the far left, Asian versus white, American Indian versus the white population, Latino, and then we get into the socioeconomic status. You see that there is continues to be persistent disparities in terms of quality measures of care and access to care. And that was in 2012. So we see in 2014, and this is really just looking at, do we see differences in the green, which is really the worsening? We see slight changes in the green, although we see significant disparities by income status as well. So we kind of look at this as saying, in terms of a number, and this is not just mental health, substance abuse, this is cardiovascular care, it's infant mortality, it's access issues like insurance, like time to appointment, like do you have a usual provider of care? So we see that we still have significant disparities across populations and across income groups. We also know that Asian Americans have probably some of the, African Americans have some of the worst healthcare indicators in the negative direction of any population group. We also need to look at what policies do we put in place that can either address, reduce, or accentuate those disparities. So if you look at we commissioned a study to really look at what's happening in states that did not expand Medicaid as part of the Affordable Care Act, and what's the implication of that for populations of color and for behavioral health access to care. So this is looking, the map on the far left shows you the states that did not expand Medicaid for their populations. And then we looked at the top quartile of states for each of our four major ethnic racial populations. I pulled out the one on African Americans because if you look at where the highest population density of African American population is on this, I'm spatially challenged here, on the right graph, you'll see that there are concentrated population more in the southern states. If you look at where we do not have Medicaid expansion, you see there's a direct overlay there. So the issue is then, through our policy, are we in fact addressing the disparities or creating more disparities for that population group? This is just a quick overview of access to mental health services by different population groups. And this is, and this is based on SAMHSA's National Survey of Drug Use and Health that we conduct every year. And it's about a sampling of about 77,000 in a national sampling framework. So you can see there's real unevenness in terms of different population groups in terms of accessing mental health services. Okay, so Dr. Troutman shared this slide with you also. This is from World Health Organization in terms of coming from their social determinants of health. I'm sorry, I guess I'm being driven by the speed of this mouse here. So I really wanted to back up and say that, yes, I think Dr. Troutman did a great job of really looking at this, and that really less than 30% of the variance in outcomes in health is determined by our healthcare delivery system and our patient behaviors. That a lot more is accounted for what we often refer to as social determinants of health. And this does look at things like housing, employment, education, economic stability. And I want to say that we need another layer in there, that all of those determinants are also mediated by what we're looking at more increasingly as and getting more data on and studies on is implicit bias. That in each one of those systems, so in the education system, we have real good data about implicit bias in terms of how that mediates who's suspended and who's expelled from school. So if we look at education as a critical factor in terms of healthcare outcomes, but we see that many of our black and brown youth are expelled at disproportionate rates or suspended, we're putting them on a negative trajectory for educational good outcomes, which are directly tied to health outcomes. Wanted to just pull out this study. I don't have time to go into it, but it's a study looking at, done by HUD and NIMH. It's called Moving to Opportunity. It's a randomized control study of looking at moving people from concentrated areas of poverty into less concentrated areas of poverty. Really looking at, would you get better job mobility? Would you get better academic performance of children because they're attending better resource schools? Some of the critical findings were they found decreases in mothers' depression, decreases in mothers' diabetes, and improved sleep patterns. So this wasn't necessarily a health study. It was really looking at an intervention in housing, but with significant implications for health. When mothers are living in less violent areas and not needing to be hypervigilant, they sleep better. Sleep is a precursor to diabetic issues and depression issues. So we're looking here clearly as a housing policy, as a social determinant of health. We haven't heard, whoa, 2 minutes. Okay, so we haven't heard a lot about the justice-involved population. This is just a slide that shows you the disproportionality and the prevalence of higher chronic diseases in the justice population, the inmate population, and this if you, okay. So, that's something that we need to pay attention to. To a certain extent, the justice population, I'm not touching these at all. The justice population has become the de facto mental health system. We have high rates of people with mental health and substance use issues in the justice system. Okay, so just examples of, I don't know, this is just. Okay. That's okay. So you get the idea. I really wanted to say that we need to look at other sectors that have a significant impact on health outcomes and very much interact with our healthcare system, whether we want to do that with intention or not. So we need to think about integrated care as different kinds of models. Okay, so we've talked a lot about it yesterday in particular about really the coordination between physical and behavioral health care. My premise here is that we really need to go beyond just the primary care system and the behavioral health system. That is one model. We've also talked more about the model of integrating behavioral health into primary care. Which we can probably more readily do because we have a more robust primary care system than we do a mental health or behavioral health system. But I do want to put out there also that some people, particularly people with serious mental illness or kids with serious emotional disorders, which we have traditionally carved out, may look at their behavioral health provider as their primary source of care. So we need to really think about what's the bidirectionality. And to be honest, some primary care practices don't want to see our patients in their clinics. I did a presentation before a number of primary care providers saying that now you can cover the jail population because they're going to have insurance. And they said, no, we don't want to cover that population. So we have a lot of implicit bias in our own healthcare delivery system that we need to think about who we're giving resources to and who are not. So we need to look at expanding the behavioral health primary care integration with non-health services, with social services, with housing, with employment, with educational opportunities. We need to look at integration of levels of care at different system infrastructure levels. We have accountable care organizations that are looking at hospital clinic providers, and are also now, some of them in very innovative ways, are building those bridges with the social service providers. And I think we need to look at models that we've had and that we funded. This is what I call the old wine in new bottles. We have had major investments in looking at how do you wrap around services and systems of care for our deep end populations. We can't throw those out. We can't throw the lessons learned out for them. We actually have very good financing policies for them, some of those deep end populations. So just going through this very quickly, okay. So we do have examples of Medicaid ACOs that are in fact building in the relationships with the social service systems. And Hennepin County, Camden, New Jersey, some examples. We have a program that's really looking at integrating primary care into behavioral health care, and we're looking at measures that both systems want. Do you have reduced ER visits for physical health reasons? And this is in the Black and the Latino population. And do you have decreased ER visits for physical health care problems? We see that also when we're integrating in the less usual direction of mental health, of healthcare into primary care. So I'm just confused where I am on my slides now. It's totally gone. So, and health homes. Ron made mention to health homes, a 2703 provision in the Affordable Care Act. And we are one of the agencies that reviews the proposals coming in from the states. And while they were initially designated for 6 chronic care conditions, we work very closely with CMS, and you as a state can propose a chronic care condition and justify that to get that as a covered condition. So for example, we are looking at complex trauma now as a chronic condition that can be eligible for the enhanced federal match payment coming through health homes. And health homes will cover those kind of coordination tasks, case management, working across systems to get a whole wraparound of services for the individual that's eligible. System of care approach, I mentioned this, we've been doing this for years with our children with serious emotional disorders that are building and keeping kids out of deeper and institutional care by building those connections with community-based providers that are not just mental health providers, not just substance abuse providers, not just primary care providers, but are the ones that are going to get you tutoring for your schools, that are going to get you recreational activities to deal with an overactive person with ADHD. So anyway, so I'd be happy to answer questions. That's kind of all I have to say now.
Morning, everybody. Delighted to be here, and like others, I'd like to congratulate President Barry Anton and Dr. Maryanne McCabe and the Planning Committee on such a brilliant, inspirational meeting and bunch of speakers. And like others, I very much enjoyed this morning, in particular Adewale Troutman, and our interests so closely coincide, and he added such insight and passion to those interests. I'd like to start by jumping straight in the deep end. As you can see, I want to talk about integration as if people mattered. Some of you will know that phrase from the famous Small is Beautiful, economics as if people mattered, and we're still waiting for that one. One of the ways in which people-centred integration occurs in the UK is that doctors like Nav Chana, I'm praying that the auto-forward is not working, that doctors like Nav Chana can refer patients for, can do what is called social prescribing, which means not prescribing a drug or a treatment in the normal fashion, but prescribing, for example, exercise on prescription, sending a patient to a local sports facility for a course of exercise, or prescribing employment or housing advice, or arts on prescription. And this varies in different parts of the country, but we have quite a bit of it in Liverpool. And I want to start, as your family physician, by doing some arts on prescription for you. I've prescribed you a poem linked with this theme of inequalities, which I want to share with you. It was written by a brilliant American physician who tragically died at the age of 30 in 1970 from leukemia, Kenneth Dale Biernink. And it's from a book called Ward Rounds, and each chapter, each poem in the book was a particular case study. And this is baby Brenda Bulewski, Failure to Thrive. Minikin skeleton stretched with rice paper skin. In one hand I held you, a tissue and balsa creation, tethered by tiny IV tubing, tenuously placed in a thread-sized vein on your scalp. I transfused thimblefuls of blood, and when you'd taken 30 mils of milk by mouth, I watched the painful peristalsis pass beneath your navel like a miniature bag of worms. And I smiled when the nurses dubbed you Tiger and taped a small pink bow atop your bald, translucent, six-week-old skull. No one believed that your mother, just 15, loved you like her record collection, or that she had been trying to feed you hamburger and beans. And when you'd regained your birth weight, we taught her of milk and nipples and belches, and we discharged you into a more gentle world. So I'm going to talk, as I say, about integration as if people mattered. And so just to start, I'll just zoom through this one because a number of us have been a little uncertain about what precisely we want to integrate. And I did do a hell of a lot of research and I still wasn't sure. But it seems to me that what we want to integrate is somewhere on this list. Healthcare and social care, physical health and mental health services, and that's featured a lot, I think, in this meeting. Staff and patients, health professions, different care providers, hospital and community settings for care, primary, secondary, and tertiary prevention. So I'd like, if possible, to address all those, but I'll fail miserably. So what are the obstacles to patient-centered, or as I only realized subsequently, I should really have said person-centered care? Just a few lessons from our National Health Service, which Nav briefly described before, the English NHS. Firstly, from our care system, from the NHS, it's very obvious to me that there are care system problems with your non-integration, the most obvious being care charges. I know you can't change that overnight, but I think everyone in this room and on the webinar would agree that health, like education and other aspects of well-being, is far too important to be left to the market and what people can afford. And I know I don't need to say any more about that, but care charges is a key issue. And as Nav said, our care is largely free at the point of use. And that, I hope, is what you aspire to. Fragmented care systems, and I think we've had a number of examples of fragmentation between care systems. And we're getting a lot of that in our health service at the moment, because sadly we have a lunatic Reagan Thatcher style neoliberal government which passed horrendous legislation in 2012, the Health and Social Care Act, which is dismantling our health service basically. It was written by corporate lawyers. Incomplete population coverage. I know that insurance schemes specialize in excluding people who pose a risk. That's how insurance works. But people like me, a diabetic with lots of complications, they're the people that health systems are there for, and you need complete population coverage. Provider competition. Once again, something that I know happens a lot here, and happens to an increasing extent in our country, but clearly it's unnecessary in terms of good health, integrated health systems, and it works against people. you know, if I want my hernia repaired, I just want a high-quality hospital down the road where I can get it done and have my friends come and relatives come and visit me. I don't want to travel 100 miles away because that hospital, as it were, won out in provider competition. And commercial confidentiality, something that is usually a load of nonsense but is used a lot in order to keep information away from the public. And increasingly, it's happening in our health service that people are unable to share information they should be able to share because the privateers and the asset strippers claim commercial confidentiality to protect their investments. Further obstacles relating to professional problems. Sorry, I just need to check if I've got the right slide up. Yes, I have. We talked about quite a few of these in our work group yesterday, and I'm sure other groups did as well. Doctors, i.e. the dominance of the medical model and the medical profession. And these issues are very much about power inequalities between the health professions represented in this room and out there in the health system. High-tech physical health specialties. We all know that the ones that the public like watching on TV and that make the newspaper headlines, you know, the cardiothoracic surgery and neurosurgery and so on, are the ones that often grab the resources because they have the attention of the public and the politicians and those who allocate resources. So clearly that's a problem for the mental health sector and other, what shall I say, partly marginalized sectors. Professionalism. We're all professionals. We like to think we've had a long training and we are experts and we have a right to say what goes in our field, but we don't. We should be better, more humble, better at sharing care with our clients and our patients than perhaps we are. And curative services tend to dominate over preventive services. Okay, so a few quick solutions to these problems, many of which I think I've implied already. Total population coverage in a single payer health and ideally social care system would be a damn good start. I know, once again, you're not going to get that overnight. I mean, all Obama got after several years of fighting was the Affordable Care Act, which is great in its way, but which is a relatively marginal gain, particularly if you think about those Americans who are still uninsured or who, despite being insured, have access to minimal care. Free at the point of use. Once again, that's when you get your, what I've heard called Medicare for All system, which I hope you do get one day. It needs to be free at the point of use and funded through taxation. Universal, it needs to be available everywhere in the country. Comprehensive, a full range of services need to be available to all. By the way, our Health and Social Care Act denies all of these things that are listed here. We still have what remains of the health service because our Prime Minister Cameron was a PR specialist before he became a politician, and he knows how to fool the public. But basically, he's doing what Thatcher was unable to do. And I've published papers, which I'm happy to share, giving the history of those developments. Centralized quality standards and responsibilities. We are now getting devolved regional systems in our country, and that means the loss of national quality standards, the loss of national paying conditions, etc. Primary care as gatekeeper to secondary care. I think you all know about primary care centered services, so I don't need to say any more about that one. Patient, user, and staff participation is something that's been mentioned quite a lot at this meeting, but it seems to me that ideally what you need is participative planning and management of patient or person-centered and integrated care systems and services with patients or clients or people and with staff and with labor unions all taking part on an equal basis. In other words, the managers and so on should not just talk to each other, but should talk to the staff and the patients who actually have an awful lot to offer in relation to how their care should be managed. Jumping from that to a different thing, which I think is a potential solution, I do a lot of work, as Barry mentioned, on health impact assessment, and I was very proud to be part of the development of a mental well-being impact assessment tool, which we piloted about 7 or 8 years ago. This is the second edition, and it's available on the internet. And I would like to see all public policy, not just health policy, subjected to either health or mental well-being impact assessment, because we all know that everything in life, social determinants of health, everything in life affects your health and well-being. So impact assessment of that sort is very important. And I'm delighted that health impact assessment has started to take off in the US thanks to the Health Impact Project, which was funded by the Pew and Robert Wood Johnson Foundation. We've got a new head of our main opposition party who has actually put a mental health minister in the shadow cabinet. In other words, he's decided not just to have health represented in the cabinet, but mental health with a separate shadow minister who happens to be my MP, in fact. And I think that's a very progressive move that I'd like to see the APA pressing for in this country. Jumping to another thing that I think is very important, just therapy. I'm just going to say a few words about the therapeutic level. This is a wonderful bunch of people in New Zealand, and you can see their URL at the bottom there, familycentre.org.nz. And as you can see, what they are is a reflective approach to therapy developed by workers at the Family Centre in Wellington, New Zealand. Fundamental feature of therapy is the attention paid to the broad cultural, gender, social, spiritual, economic, and psychological contexts underlying the problems experienced by those with whom therapists work. And they are the best people who are actually using treatment to address the inequalities, problems that our populations face that I've come across anywhere in the world. Another related initiative in Glasgow in Scotland was this Inequalities Sensitive Practice Initiative. And this is about changing policies to reflect the needs of those who suffer inequalities. And one particular aspect that was of great interest to me as a medical teacher was that they actually, every doctor in Glasgow at every level, including the best, richest, whatever, most powerful high-tech consultants, had to have some mandatory training in empathizing and dealing with the health needs that related to the inequalities experienced by ordinary people in Glasgow. And that, to me, is very much a way forward in terms of how we do our health professions training. This is social prescribing, which I mentioned earlier. And I don't know whether you have it here. I'm sorry to show my ignorance, but it's a brilliant initiative. The idea that, you know, that your GP, your family doctor, doesn't just prescribe drugs and surgery and radiotherapy and CBT and psychoanalysis on the NHS. I don't know whether you get it on your Medicare, I sense not. But that they can prescribe, as I said, art therapies, exercise on prescription, housing advice, welfare rights advice, etc., etc. Social prescribing, a great mental health initiative. And I just want to finish by drawing attention to something that Adewale mentioned this morning. I thought that while every word he said was absolutely brilliant, you remember that most of the examples he gave inevitably came from overseas. He talked a lot about what the WHO said. And the reason, I know you're here somewhere, Aduwale, but because of my vision, I can't see you. The reason that you had to do that, of course, is because your country doesn't put into practice an awful lot of the things that the World Health Organization knows need to be done. And the Commission on Social Determinants of Health, sadly, reported in 2008, had and took place from 2005 to 8. Had it taken place during the Obama period rather than the Bush period, then the American rep on the commission would, I'm sure, have been a lot more progressive, and we would have had even better and less restrained recommendations from that commission. But what I'm drawing to attention here, Aduwale talked about the right to health, if you remember, from the UN Convention, and the UN right to health, defined in 1948, is part of the International Convention on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights. And that map shows you which countries in the world have signed up to it. The dark blue ones, I think they are. And you can see the orange, I think they are, countries are the few reactionary countries in a few parts of the world that haven't done anything at all in relation to that convention. And that big blob of light blue in North America means that the treaty has not been ratified by the US. So those wonderful rights to health that Aduwale talked about, you guys don't have. What happened, the reason you're blue and not orange, is that Jimmy Carter had the progressiveness to sign the treaty, but he knew damn well that those folks there on the Hill would not ratify it, and sure enough, they didn't, and no government since has ratified it. So the US is the only country in the so-called economic developed world that has not ratified the right to health, and more broadly, the International Convention on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. And I hope very much that following this meeting, the APA will produce a Hill briefing to draw this to their attention. I picked that phrase up this morning. In conclusion, just a semantic note, really. Integration is a bit of a parenthood and apple pie word, isn't it? And integrating care, but clearly integrating care into packages for the convenience of HMOs and insurance companies has nothing to do with meaningful, people-centered integration. Perhaps we need to start using a new word to denote what we really want, which is seamless, collaborative care without financial or psychological barriers, focused entirely on improving patient health and well-being. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Scott Samuel. We have about 10 minutes for questions and responses from our panelists, so we can get right into those questions. And I'm sure that our panelists will be available this afternoon for additional conversation. So I see a question in the back here.
Representing the Gerontological Society of America. Great panel. There was a study done by Robert Wood Johnson in 2011 that spoke to healthcare's blind side, and it interviewed something like 1,000 primary care physicians, a fairly nice N, and they talked about that they, when they thought about prescribing, one out of seven prescriptions would be for social care reasons. Now, why I have to say this, though, as I'm facing Congress, is our social service system in this country is falling apart, particularly our safety net aspect of it. And it's a lot of it is going on down the street, but as well, it's going on because the states are falling apart. And every day I hear about another system, at least in Illinois, closing its doors. So it's incumbent upon us, as we're thinking about being leaders and activists in this world, to think about funding that social service structure in a different way as it's done in other countries. So just wanted to put that plea out for a policy message as well.
Wonderful, thank you. Other questions, comments? OK, Okay, let me pose a question to our panelists while you're gathering your thoughts. Dr. Trautman's brilliant presentation reminds us about the array of social, economic, and environmental determinants, particularly at the root of health inequities that we see in this country. And so part of our conversation leaves the question open with this kind of experimentation going on across healthcare systems and a host of external partners working to address these social and economic and environmental determinants. How can integrated care models contribute to this kind of collaboration toward health equity, to any of the panelists?
I think one thing that needs to be said is that, as Dr. Trautman said this morning, healthcare only influences a relatively small proportion of the variance in health or morbidity or mortality. So we do need to bear that in mind. I think it's clear from every presentation that we've had really at this meeting that integrated care unquestionably can contribute. And from my fellow panelists, it very clearly is contributing substantially in relation to minority and marginalized and unequal groups. But we do need to bear in mind that ultimately, as was said earlier, it is the social and economic and cultural determinants of health that perhaps carry the greatest weight.
I think we need to transfer a lot of the technology and the methods for assessment and monitoring to the community leaders. I think we have very great frameworks and metrics, but we need to translate it into the community leaders for them also to be part of the changes. From the perspective of the higher education institutions, I think we need to change the paradigm. At Hopkins has been very difficult, even for me, to put the new model of equity versus the etiological research, when most of the faculty members and the students are receiving funding for NIH for etiological research and not for equity-focused problems that are actually the most important problems. I think we need to change on also the way as we training our leaders and our future leaders. The second is that we need to take in the primary healthcare different visions. I think the role of the schools should be, when I see primary healthcare, I see the schools. I don't see the health centers. Then schools should be, children will be the ambassadors for the new vision of public health and equity. The second is we are seeing that children have more influence for their adolescent brothers and sisters than their parents and teachers. Now we are seeing that many changes will come from children when they will be ambassadors that understand equity and public health.
So I have a couple of responses. One, I think communities are getting more sophisticated about data and how to use data. So I can go to my community, a zip code, and I can look at all the crime that occurs in my zip code, and I can look at the type of crime. And so I know that we're trying to look at more community-level data indicators, and I think I heard presentations on that yesterday, so that you can actually start to hotspot for different kinds of conditions. We have certainly a lot of that being done in the cancer arena. I think we can do that in some of the arenas that we're particularly concerned with. I also want to go back to the Commission on the Social Determinants of Health and a question that came up earlier. About children. The number one recommendation coming out of that commission to countries was an investment in early childhood, an investment in early care and education. So I think we need to take stock of that and see what that does for communities and families and putting kids on the right trajectory. I also think that we know from the research that when we do things for all peoples, it doesn't get to all people. But when we do things for targeted groups, it tends to get to all people. And I'll stay with the early childhood education piece. When we did studies back in the 60s and 70s, the Perry Preschool Project, Abecedarian, Chicago Preschool, those were on African-American populations. And that brought us universal preschool, brought us universal kindergarten. It wasn't on, let's try this for everybody and see if it trickles down to disparity vulnerable populations. So I have to think, we have to kind of frame and think about what populations we're really concerned with, and that how do we target meaningful evidence-supported interventions, and how that may in fact bring up other populations in addition to the targeted population versus the other way. I think we've seen that hasn't worked.
Thank you. I think we have time for one final question. John Young.
Hi, good morning, John Young. I heard Alex read a very compelling story, and when I think of clinical quality measurement, I think of the notion of narratives in healthcare, if you will. So we have a system where we have just hordes of clinical quality measures, but where is the patient narrative in all of this, and how do we begin to use the narrative and begin to use narrative to actually validate measures? There's a really compelling article in the New England Journal of Medicine that suggested narrative as a science, and so it's not really a question, but sort of a comment to figure out how do we really get down to the patient level narrative and use that in a meaningful way beyond CAPS and other patient experience of care tools.
I think it's very much about participatory planning. I think that informatics, like other areas of health practice and research, is as much subject to expertism as all the rest. And we need to push the paradigm of user involvement, basically, in every aspect of healthcare, and this one is no exception. And as we've heard to some extent during this meeting, the measures we use are not user-friendly measures. We had an example in the previous panel. They're not the indicators or the factors or whatever that people will choose themselves. And we need to listen to what people want us to do for their health and translate that into quality indicators.
Excellent. Well, please join me in thanking this wonderful panel. Great discussion. Thank you very much.